Playboy magazine started by Hugh Hefner. Hefner, over the decades, gosh, he seemed to have quite the lifestyle for a long time. A lot of men, you know, was kind of culturally accepted to envy Hefner.
I remember, like, he used to have these parties. The who's who would be there at these parties.
Oh, at the mansion in L.A., and he wore pajamas to work, and he seemed to be surrounded by girls who were really, really into him. Well, we're learning a few details about life inside the Playboy mansion from that woman right there. Her name is Holly Madison, a former Playboy bunny and a former girlfriend of Hugh Hefner's, one of many. Holly is the author of a new book. It's called Down the Rabbit Hole, Curious Adventures and Cautionary Tales of a Former Playboy Bunny. Holly, welcome to Good Day.
Thanks for having me.
How you doing? Boy,
I'm
oh
good.
Boy, this book is getting a lot of press.
Yeah, I wasn't even expecting it. It's crazy.
But you had to expect something because you went after Hugh Hefner, right?
Yeah, I definitely expected some attention, but nothing like this. It's really...
What was your intention when you wrote the book?
Well, when I wrote the book, it wasn't about, you know, being mad or having an axe to grind or anything like that. I just wanted to tell my side of the story because for so many years, you know, I left the mansion 7 years ago, and I always wanted to start fresh. I didn't want to, you know, ride on Playboy's coattails anymore. I wanted to, you know, do my own things and be known for who I was. And for so many years because of that, I just wouldn't even talk about Playboy. If people would ask me about it, I'd just give some kind of benign, you know, nice answer to just get the question out of the way. And I kind of felt like I was living a lie because, you know, still every so often I meet people and they're like, hey, you still talk to Hef? And I'm like, no. And they look at me and they want to know why. And I just felt like I couldn't really be honest about my experience. And he always had a chance to tell his side of the story through the things he picked for the show, which he controlled, or articles he had written about us for his magazine. So I thought it was only fair that I share my story.
So when people, I could see people asking that because we all kind of had this sense, oh, Hef's a cool guy. He's laid back. How old were you when you met him?
22.
And he was how old?
I think he was like 85.
85. And you entered into would you call it a romantic relationship? From the outside looking in, you were boyfriend, girlfriend.
Yeah, definitely. Actually, I think he was 76. Sorry.
And you went in there not because you liked him, but what were your motivations?
I did actually like him. I thought, you know, he has this great personality on the outside.
As boyfriend material?
Yeah, and he comes off as, like, you know, a nice guy, and I wanted to believe that about him for so many years. And, of course, I was attracted to the lifestyle as well and thought that being in Playboy would be a great stepping stone, but I just got myself in way too deep and really lost myself the 7 years I was there.
You talk about some of the first experiences that you had with Hugh, and it wasn't a pretty picture. I mean, you know, you talk about... there was zero intimacy involved, no kissing, nothing. It was so brief that I can't even recall what it felt like beyond having a heavy body on top of mine.
Yeah, that was the hardest chapter for me to write, definitely. It was
Why?
The one that I kept wanting to skip over and come back to. It was the hardest for me to remember because I was heavily intoxicated that night, and also it was just something I'd, you know, blocked from my mind for so long and never wanted to talk about, and was kind of a painful memory for me because it wasn't what I wanted the relationship to be like.
When you were a bunny, were there drugs also involved?
Well, he offered me Quaaludes the first night out, and I thought it was really bizarre. I barely knew what a Quaalude was. You know, no young girl did in 2001.
You quoted him as saying something in the book.
Oh, yeah. He said in the 70s they used to call them thigh openers, and I thought, well, this is really bizarre. And over the years, I saw him offer them to girls every night we would go out.
Do you think he was a pedophile?
I don't think he was a pedophile.
I'm just asking because he liked young girls.
Well, I understand, but
Greg,
you're... Well,
and he's in his 70s and 80s, and he's going after 18 and 19-year-old girls.
Well, sorry, but you were in your early 20s, right?
Yeah, but I think he liked people who were, you know, starstruck and easy to control, and those were certainly, you know, like me, were the type of people who are most likely to fall for him.
So was he a control freak? Tell us about the rules of the house.
There were a lot of rules. You know, I didn't necessarily know exactly what I was getting into when I moved in as far as all the rules. I knew there was a 9 o'clock curfew, but I soon found out you also weren't really allowed to fraternize with the staff too much, or he'd get jealous. I was asked to quit my waitressing job not long after I moved in, which it was just a waitressing job, but I feel like that was a big mistake for me because it was me kind of giving up the last of my independence.
But you were desperate at the time, right?
Yeah,
I mean, you know,
I was
broke.
Yeah, I was broke. I was losing my lease on my apartment. I was in college. You know, I wanted to stay in LA and make it. And I thought, you know, this seemed like kind of a light, fun situation. And I just got myself in way too deep.
I heard the mansion was a bit of a wreck on the inside.
It's a very beautiful property, but it had some, you know, gross carpet and a lot of dogs.
And wow, and you were one of how many girlfriends for Hef?
There were 7 girlfriends when I first moved in.
And, I mean, I'm just trying to, because it seemed from the excerpts that you weren't into him. I heard a moment ago you kind of liked his personality. I mean, what were the feelings between the two of you, at least on your side?
Well, I definitely liked his personality, and I blamed the girls for a lot of the problems. I always thought, well, you know, they're mean to him, they pick on me, they make fun of him behind his back. So I always blamed the girls for the problems and for why I wasn't happy in the relationship for so long. But, you know, now that I have a little bit of hindsight behind me, I see that, you know, he was really the manipulator and didn't want us getting along because that served him better.
And you talked about how the girls would fake it, too, with him in intimate.
Oh, yeah, all the girls wanted to get out of the bedroom as quickly as possible, and they all kind of acted like they were into each other, but nothing was really
so
happening on that.
So you now is like, I guess he's either read the excerpts or he's heard about the book, and he's not too happy about the book, and he's released a statement. In it, he says, sadly, there are a few who have chosen to rewrite history in an attempt to stay in the spotlight. I guess, as the old saying goes, you can't win them all. He's, you know, basically saying you have revisionist history.
Definitely not. Everything in my book is absolutely true. I know it's not the version of the story he'd like to tell, but I have as much right to tell my story as he's always had to tell his. So
it did seem kind of weird from the outside that he would have so many girlfriends. I mean, you were one of how many again?
Seven.
Seven.
You kind of, though, expected, like, he was this great, like, you know, lover. And he wasn't, right?
You just
laughed.
Yeah, I don't think that's why any of those girls were there.
It was all about career furtherance, right? And
yeah, definitely. Everybody saw it as, you know, some kind of a great opportunity.
So how were you able to basically get out of his clutches and go on your own?
Well, you know, for so many years, I tried to be happy, and I tried to be the best girlfriend I could, and, you know, I tried to love him, and it got to a point when I was there for 7 years and Bridget and Kendra were kind of going their separate ways and I was becoming the only girlfriend, which was what I thought I wanted for so long and what everybody else thought I wanted. And without the other girls to kind of play off of, his personality really started shining through and, you know, we got in several stupid arguments over the course of one weekend where I kind of felt, you know, I felt like I was really learning who he was and I couldn't really take it anymore.
Your family, were they pressuring you to get out of that situation? I mean, looks a lot of bad stuff happened like the first week.
Yeah, you know, well, I definitely didn't confide anything in my family. I was really embarrassed by a lot of the situation. And I think one of the reasons I stayed there for so long is because I was embarrassed by the decision I made and I felt really branded and judged by it. So I definitely didn't talk to my parents about it and just tried to make it seem like it was, you know, really benign thing.
Did you do a lot of drinking and drugs to kind of get through that period?
I didn't do drugs, but I did drink a lot anytime we went out because I would get bored or, you know, not feel good about myself or not, you know, I wasn't happy being around the other girls necessarily.
Right. Club nights, Wednesday and Friday. That was the drill. What was the daily routine there, if you could, real quick?
We were kind of free to do what we wanted during the day, but we weren't really allowed to work. So it was a lot of, you know, going to the salon or I started taking some classes on the side, things like that. And then we were expected to go out with him on Wednesday and Friday and be there for buffets on the weekends and things like
so,
that.
So kind of, I mean, allegedly a chauvinist in a way, right?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I mean, I think that was obvious to everyone but me at one point.
So The shows and everything, the TV shows. I mean, you could have left several times, but you chose not to because...
Well, there's a lot of reasons.
Easy money?
No, I mean, I don't think it was so much about the money. I think it was so more to me about how I felt I would be judged once I left and all this baggage I was carrying with me and how was I going to redefine myself. And I was kind of scared of that. And I was kind of right to be because I'm still, you know, talking about it now and kind of, you know, just now telling my side of the story because it's definitely the only thing people think of when they think of you and definitely.
So when you look back, are you, do you regret being a Playboy bunny?
No, because I think I learned a lot from it and there were some positive experiences that came out of it, definitely. But I wish I would have had, you know, my head screwed on my shoulders a little bit more and, you know, maybe kept that outside job and kept that feeling of independence.
Folks, if you want to meet Holly Madison, you can. There's a book signing. Let's go ahead and put it up on the screen, please.
Today, 7 o'clock at Books and Greetings in Northvale, New Jersey.
I think there's going to be a big line, Holly.
I know.
I hope so.
And then tomorrow at 12:30 at Barnes & Noble on East 54th Street in New York City.
Wow. What about a movie, huh?
Oh, I would love that. I think that'd be amazing.
Huh. There's already one, Star 80. You ever see that?
Yeah, and I read the book behind it, too.
That was pretty intense. All right, Holly Madison, thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.